People from all over the world have reported encounters with mysterious beings. They appear to bring important messages or lend much-needed assistance, then vanish without a trace. Could they be angels or even guardian angels? Some of the most fascinating and uplifting stories of the unexplained are those that people perceive as being miraculous in nature. Sometimes they take the form of answered prayers or are interpreted as the actions of guardian angels. These remarkable events and encounters lend comfort, strengthen faith, and even save lives. They almost always seem to happen when they are needed most. Are they literally from heaven, or are they the result of the interaction of our consciousness with a profoundly mysterious universe? However you view them, these real-life experiences are worth our attention. First story. Rescued from hopelessness. Perhaps more painful than any injury or illness is the feeling of utter hopelessness, the despair of the soul that leads one to thoughts of suicide. Dean S. experienced this pain as he was going through a divorce at the age of 26. The thought of being apart from his two young daughters was almost more than he could bear. But on one night of stormy darkness, Dean was given renewed hope. At the time, he was working as a craneman on a drill rig. That night, he was having serious thoughts of taking his life as he looked down from the 128-foot crane. My family and I have strong beliefs in Jesus, but it was hard not to contemplate suicide, recalls Dean. In the worst thunderstorm I'd ever seen, I climbed the crane to take my position to pull pipe out of the hole we were drilling. His co-workers urged him not to climb the crane, saying they'd rather have downtime than risk someone's life. Dean ignored this and began to climb. Lightning flashed all around me, thunder boomed. I cried to God to take me. If I couldn't have my family, I didn't want to live, but I couldn't take my own life in suicide. God spared me. I don't know how I survived that night, but I did. A couple of weeks later, I bought a small Bible and traveled to the Peace River Hills, where my family has lived for so long. I sat down on top of one of the green hills and started to read. I had such a warm feeling enter into me as the sun parted through the clouds and shone on me. It was raining all around me, but I was dry and warm in my small spot on top of that hill. Dean says that these moments changed his life for the better. He met his new wife and fell in love. They started a family together that includes his two daughters. He says, "Thank you, Lord Jesus and the angels you sent that day to touch my soul." Second accounts of angels. Life information from an angel. Some people believe that before we are born, when our consciousness or spirit resides in that unknown place, we are given information about the life we are about to be born into. Some say we even choose our life. Not many people can claim that they remember this pre-birth existence, but Gary says he does. In fact, even in his middle-aged years, Gary says he can recall some details of a conversation he had with an angel before he was born. "I was bodiless, but aware that I was in an area that was darkened, and I was alone except for the entity that was speaking to me," he says. "I was at the bottom of a stairway-type structure and was looking up the stairs, but not seeing the one speaking to me. I was very warm and comfortable, but aware, and feeling trepidation of what I was about to embark on. This entity was speaking to me and giving me a brief description of how my life would be. I asked for more information, but it was refused. I was basically told that my life would not be a hard life, but would lack any luxuries and that I would experience great difficulties at a relatively early age. It seems there were a few other small details, but I no longer can remember it quite as clearly as I once did when I was younger. It appears the information was correct as I'm now disabled and in poor health." Third account of angels. The angel nurse. In 1998, Luke was diagnosed with bone cancer at the tender age of 8. As sometimes happens, he came down with an infection, which meant he had to go to the hospital. He was there for about 2 weeks, and that's when something remarkable happened. One evening, Luke's mother was sitting at his bedside quietly praying as he slept. A nurse came into the room to check Luke's temperature, but his mother noted something rather peculiar about her. The nurse was wearing an old-fashioned uniform of the type that would have been common 30 years earlier, in the 1960s. The nurse noticed that Luke's mother had a Bible by the side of his bed. She said that she was a Christian, too, and said she would pray for Luke's healing. Luke's family had never seen this odd nurse before, and they never saw her again in Luke's remaining time at the hospital. "I came out of the hospital fully healed of my infection," says Luke, who was 19 when he told his story. Remarkably, he is now completely free of cancer. "My mom believes this nurse could have been a guardian angel coming down to give my mom some hope," Luke says. "If she wasn't an angel, why would she be wearing 1960s old-fashioned nurse clothing?" Fourth account by an angel. Pushed to safety by an angel. Back in 1980, Deb was a single mother with two infants living in San Bernardino County, California. She occasionally needed reliable babysitters. Fortunately, her parents lived only about 30 miles away in Alta Loma. Deb would usually drop off the children at her parents' house, go do what she needed to do, then pick them up in the evening. One night, Deb had retrieved her babies from her parents' place and was heading home. It was relatively late, about 11:30 p.m. Deb was driving her old clunker. Among the car's many deficiencies, the gas gauge was broken, requiring her to guess when the old thing needed fuel. Occasionally, her guessing was off. Halfway home, the car started to putter, Deb remembers, and I realized I was on empty. I pulled off the first off-ramp I could, and it just happened to be one that was slightly uphill. Almost at the top of the exit, my car died and there was absolutely nothing around except empty fields and distant lights at a truck stop about a quarter of a mile down the road. With no cars in sight, Deb didn't know what to do. The kids were asleep and walking miles while carrying two kids in the middle of the night was not a good option. This was before cell phones, so she could not call for help. "I put my head on the steering wheel while saying a short and panicky prayer," she says. "I hadn't even finished when I heard a few taps on my window. When she looked up, she saw a clean-cut young man standing there, who Deb estimated to be about 21 years old. He motioned for her to roll down her window. I remember I was surprised," Deb says, "but I wasn't even the slightest bit afraid, even though I normally would have been terrified. The young man was dressed well and had a faint smell of soap. He didn't ask if she needed help. Instead, he told her to put the car in neutral and he would help her over that last, small hill toward a place where she could get gas. I thanked him and followed his instructions. The car started moving. I steered it toward the lights of the truck stop and turned around to yell thank you again to him," Deb says. "He was so nice. My car kept moving, but the young man was nowhere in sight. I mean, this area was completely remote. There was absolutely nowhere he could have gone that quickly, even if there was somewhere to go. I don't even know where he came from to begin with." Fifth account of angels. The accident warnings. Is our future predestined, and is this how psychics and prophets can see the future? Or is the future only a set of possibilities, a path that can be altered by our actions? A reader with the username Hfen writes about how she received two separate and remarkable warnings about a possible incident in the future. They may have saved her life. One night, at about 4 in the morning, Hfen's sister called her. Her voice was trembling and she was nearly crying. Since her sister lived across the country and it was so early, Hfen was obviously worried. "She told me she had a vision of me being in a car accident. She didn't say whether or not I was killed in it, but the sound of her voice made me think she did believe this but was afraid to tell me," Hfen writes. "She told me to pray and she said she would pray for me. She told me to be careful, to take another route to work, anything I could do. I told her I believed her and would call our mother and ask her to pray with us." When Hfen left for work, she was terrified but strengthened in the spirit. She worked at a hospital and had patients to attend to. As she was leaving a room, she was called over by a gentleman in a wheelchair. I went to him expecting that he had a complaint against the hospital. He told me God had given him a message that I would be in a car accident. He said someone not paying attention would hit me. I was so shocked I almost fainted. He said he would pray for me and that God loved me. I felt weak in the knees as I left the hospital. I drove like a little old lady as I observed every intersection, stop sign, and stoplight. When I got home, I called my mom and sister and told them I was fine. Deb's car continued to roll down the hill until it reached the truck stop. She was able to get the gas she needed, and the kids remained sound asleep. I've always trusted in God to take care of us, but in relating that story many times to my children, who are now 30 and 32, they know for a fact that angels do exist and are sent to us if we just believe. I always thought it was so amazing that we were sent someone who I would trust instinctively without question. Since that incident, I've come to believe that we probably encounter angels all the time, and take for granted who they really are. I think they come in all shapes and sizes, young and old, and sometimes when we least expect them. Thank you for watching. Please like and subscribe.